Our next lectures for Professor Safaa Helal. She's a professor of anaesthesia, ICU, and the pain management from Menofeyia University in Egypt. And she is going to talk about the perioperative management of the peritoneal patient with multiple sclerosis. She's supervised more than 45 master and medical doctoral theses in his Menofeyia University. And she is very interested in the education and the training of the resident and junior staff. And she has a special interest in obstetric anesthesia. And her lectures is the perioperative management of the peritoneal patient with multiple sclerosis. Welcome, Dr. Safaa.
Thank you. Thank you. Very nice, Dr. Yasser. Good night, everybody. Good night. I'm great honor. It's a great honor for me to be among you. Thank you for my professor, Dr. the iconic one, Dr. Saad Mahdi, and the iconic mentor for me, Dr. Yasser Zaghloul. Thank you. My topic is perioperative management of parturient with multiple sclerosis. Yes, what is MS or multiple sclerosis? Multiple sclerosis is a disease one of the most common long-term condition affecting the CNS, brain, spinal cord, and the main cause of non-traumatic disability in young adults. MS is a neurodegenerative disease, a group of conditions that include Parkinsonism, Alzheimer, and Huntington disease. MS is diagnosed by the age of 20 and 40. The incidence of MS is 1 per 100,000 individual. Male to female ratio in one is 1:3. This is a very nice young woman who was affected by MS. Yes. It's an autoimmune disease of CNS affecting the brain, a spinal cord, and optic nerve mainly, where the myelin sheath covered by Schwann cell were attacked by autoimmune process, inflammatory autoimmune process, causing exposure, healed by fibrous tissue, scar tissue found, damaged the myelin. When the impulse pass in its direct pathway, like that one on the right, but on the left, the, when the impulse pass in damaged pathway, cytokine will be released and the inflammatory process released. We have risk factors that initiate or and augment the occurrence or the attacking of MS to some bodies, like inflammatory process causing the progression of neurological damage, Epstein-Barr viral infection, some vaccination, lack of ultraviolet, repeated exposure to organic solvent. Of course, stress is a major risk factor, as well as socioeconomic, psychiatric illness, physical and sexual abuse, all the previous factors are considered risk factors. Adding to that, 25% of pregnant female with MS vulnerable to anxiety and depression during labor. So we have to manage this thoroughly to avoid relapse. Anesthesia is a questionable risk factor. Neuroaxial anesthesia was considered a cause of relapse to patient of MS. Someone once died said that if you suspect a patient of explained weakness and numbness, you should proceed in the pathway to diagnose it as an MS unless disproved. So relating to our job, spinal or epidural anesthesia, as well as the local anesthetic, was accused as a precipitating factor in case of relapse of MS. But Dominique Cassard demonstrated on a study include 118 women with MS between 2010 and 2015. But no relation between spinal or epidural anesthesia or any of the local anesthetic used to have a relapse, related to relapse. Of course, we know the T helper cell, but we have T helper 1 and T helper 2. T helper 1 responsible for the cellular immunity and tissue rejection. T helper 2 responsible for humoral immunity and the secretion of anti-inflammatory cytokines. In normal person, T helper 1, of course, dominate, but in pregnancy, T helper 2 dominate. So during pregnancy, no relapse occurred to the patient of MS. Symptoms of MS, we have visual disturbance. We have three B's. B number 1 for the brain, B number 2 for the bowel, and B number 3 for bladder. So if we have brain symptoms like blurred vision, color distortion, loss of vision, or bowel dysfunction, or bladder dysfunction, and not explained by any disease or organic disease, it should be managed as MNS and MS and proceed to further diagnosis and investigation. This is the areas affected and symptom system affection. And this also figure also. Of course, MS is most common cause of permanent disability in youngs. Symptoms like numbness, vision problems, pain and spasm, weakness or fatigue, balance problem and disease, all of that considered for MS. According to the management of MS, we have general and anesthetic. General management, we call DMT, disease modifying therapy, in the form of bilateral male acetate zonulal, interferon B, fingolimod, natalizumab and its family, dimethyl furamate. No differences على the outcome of pregnancy in any of the used previous drugs. Treatment of attack of or relapse during pregnancy, the first choice is high-dose steroid. Why? Because it is metabolized by placenta and the fetal concentration come to 10% of the only maternal concentration. Corticosteroid wouldn't cause prematurity or low birth weight, but may cause, if initiated early, neonatal orofacial malformation and neonatal suppression of adrenal gland, but only for 6 hours after childbirth. The drug modified therapy, its elimination and the method of administration will be showered. Fingolimod have 2 months to be eliminated before pregnancy. Triflumenide 2 years wash out. So preparation for pregnancy and family and both the husband and mother should be consulted about the drugs. Is a modified drug therapy to be stopped. And we have this. And of course, natalizumab, this is a humanized monoclonal agent taken by infusion. This is one of the famous drug used. Its half-life is 11 to 16 days, possible to increase the risk of birth deficits, especially if taken in the first trimester exposure. Almetizumab, half-life is 12 days. 19 pregnancies reported have major fetal dangers. Ocrelizumab, no data available till now. Monoclonal antibody administration, human IgG, is selectively transported across the placenta. Serum concentration equal to maternal at approximately 12-week gestation. Fetal concentration may exceed maternal concentration. How to diagnose a patient with MS? Of course, MRI and the pregnancy. And MRI is conclusive method of diagnosis. Exposure of MRI during first trimester of pregnancy hasn't been shown to have a risk or harm to the fetus or an early childhood. But usage of gadolinium based contrast agent used at any time during pregnancy may be associated with rheumatological or inflammatory or infiltrative, as well as stillbirths or neonatal death. Causes of exacerbation of MS during pregnancy. Rule out pseudo exacerbation. We should firstly, if this patient have infection, medication, interaction, or toxicity, overuse, all of that can be diagnosed as pseudo exacerbation. But real exacerbation should be diagnosed thoroughly. Exacerbation treatment with high dose of corticosteroid may shorten the duration of exacerbation, but are not proven to decrease the long-term exacerbation. Treatment of postpartum remission. Interferon B, glatiramine acetate, natalizumab, steroid if severe. Of course, breastfeeding is prohibited if severe attack found. Our anesthetic management will be dependent upon patient age, severity of disability, clinical and MRI finding, rate of relapse. Before that, if we consulted about the assessment of fertilization for the pregnant female, of course, to assist fertilization, we have two techniques, one called agonist and the other is called antagonist. Those who have protocol agonist technique to assist fertilization and IVF, this is good one, cause no exacerbation of MS. But the antagonist one, by the pathway of gonadotropin-releasing hormone, which affects the proliferation of beta and T cells, will exacerbate the rate of relapse during the process of IVF. As we said lastly, general and epidural had no influence on relapse. Old theory accuses spinal anaesthesia to cause relapse, but this is not the true. Perioperative stress, of course, increases the risk of relapse, infection, emotional liability, hyperpyrexia, all can increase the incidence of relapse. We should know that if our patient have no medullary, cervical, or thoracic spine affection, general anesthesia will have no negative impact on respiratory function. But if there is medullary, cervical, or diaphragmatic affection, or thoracic spine for the respiratory muscle, of course, post-operative respiratory care should be available. Pre-oxygenation is mandatory. Diaphragmatic, of course, I will announce again that diaphragmatic paralysis recorded if cervical cord affection, no need here, preoperative pulmonary function test. Very simply, we will let our patient to inhale deeply and we have no cervical affection.
8 o'clock p.m.
Outcome and anaesthesia. No rule of type of anaesthesia will affect the baby delivery. This is the study of Italian study after and the Czech study along 10 years. We have no negative impact on child delivery, labor and delivery in MS patients with greater disability, especially motor dysfunction, not allowed to deliver vaginally, but prepared for CS. And always we will remember that fatigue is a hallmark of MS. Prolonged labor may accentuate this fatigue. Prevention of postpartum relapse will be treated by methylprednisolone 1,000 for 6 months, associated with normalization of relapse risk in case of control study. Restarting disease-modifying therapy decision should be discussed before delivery, taken into account baseline disease activity during patient pregnancy, and the patient preferences. Insurance reauthorization. If restarting the fingolimod, patient must be observed for cardiac conduction, it changes. This is our advice. Eat all the natural food. Play jam with colleagues. Here in Egypt, we have MS groups guided by a great professor in Anshams University. Do exercise with your family, hear music, enjoy all your time. Thank you. Thank you, my audience, my great audience. Thank you. Any question, Dr. Yasser?
Yes, he's here.
Yes, thank you so much for your presentation. Hello?
Dr. Yasser.
Can you hear?
Welcome.
Just have some few questions regarding the regional anesthesia. You already mentioned that there is a big problem, but it can be done during the acute relapse.
The base is if the patient can have no muscular affection, the respiratory muscle, or any regional or general anesthesia according to the situation.
Okay.
Or the surgery plan.
There is one question from Dr. Muhammad Sulaiman. He's asking too much tonight. Anyway. Should we record the deficits before anesthesia? What are the medical legal implications?
Yes. Once upon a time, I have anesthetized that patient. Briefly, before she entered the OR, I told her that we will not cure you. You will go and have laparoscopic cholecystectomy, and you will still by your disease. You will still have your disease. Yeah. Your disability, your weakness, anything you have will remain with you. But we will avoid to have extra stress for you, which can initiate any relapse and she was agreeing completely.
Yeah, there is a question, but you may be answered it during the lectures about the regional anesthesia and relapse. Is it correct?
No. After many studies, this is the Dominique Cassat and Italian study and Czech study all demonstrate that neither the regional technique nor the used local anesthetic have no negative impact on MS.
Okay, so in summary, regional anesthesia can be used in patients with multiple sclerosis safely, as you mentioned in your lecture.
Safely. Okay. But I will tell my patient that you have parathesia, not by my technique. It's already found in you.
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Professor Safaa, for this nice presentation, very concise and very summarized. And hopefully we can see you in the next meeting, inshallah.